Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. It's always in the last place you look. How many of you have heard this expression? A few years ago, I heard a comedian do a bit about this saying. He said, of course, it's in the last place you look. If you found it in the first place you look, why would you keep searching? He, of course, has a point. But it got me wondering, how much time during the day do we spend looking for things? I wanted to find out, so I did a quick Google search and I found a report that says we spend about 16 minutes a day looking for lost items. Add that all up and it comes to out about a roughly 1 year of our life looking for objects. I know as I've gotten older, I spend more and more time looking for things that at one time I knew right where they were. I put something in a nice, safe place so I wouldn't lose it. The problem is, I forgot where that nice, safe place is. Now I can't find it. The upside is, I didn't lose it, but of course, now I have no idea where it is. I think that all of us have spent time at some point looking for our glasses or a pencil that we had in our hand just a few minutes ago. You search everywhere for them, only to find your glasses have been on your forehead the whole time, and the pencil's been behind your ear for the last 10 minutes, even though you've searched everywhere for it. I think that one of the hardest situations that a parent may ever face is searching for a child. I think we've all had that moment where our parents have lost track of us for a split second. You're at a park playing on the slide or on the swings. You see a friend over in the sandbox, so you go over to sit next to her and say hi. Something distracted your mother, and she looked away for a split second just as you moved from the swings to the sandbox. When she turned back, you were gone. Of course, she jumped up frantically and started searching for you. Thankfully, most of the time, mothers locate their children right away. Of course, your mother is probably going to come over and tell you not to go anywhere without telling her for the rest of the day. She has a hard time taking her eyes off of you. What about those times when you don't find your child right away? Your daughter walks home from school every day and she's always home by 3:30 without fail. Well, now it's getting closer to 4:30 and she's still not there. You might not panic right away thinking that she got a little delayed. You might pull out your calendar to make sure you didn't miss an activity at school or an appointment that she may have stayed behind for. You might call the school or her cell phone or her friends to see if she went over to their house instead of coming straight home. Of course, I won't deny the fact that you'll probably become more and more frantic the more places you check and still don't find her. If you're like me, you'll probably get in your car and start to drive back over the route she always takes when she's walking. There are places that every parent knows their child goes to. You're going to systematically check each of them to see if your daughter is at any of them. In our reading today, Mary and Joseph are facing the exact type of situation. They have a missing child they now have to search for. Like any devout Jew, each year they make a trip to the temple in Jerusalem in order to celebrate the Passover. They traveled there on foot and would be there about a week, then travel back to Nazareth. Each year we can imagine that everything went pretty much as planned. Then one year, when Jesus was 12, things changed. Luke tells us in his gospel, "And when the feast was ended, as they were returning, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem. His parents did not know it. But supposing him to be in the group, they went a day's journey, but then they began to search for him among their relatives and acquaintances, and when they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem searching for him." Jesus, without his parents knowing, decided to stay behind rather than returning with his parents. Mary and Joseph, of course not knowing this, started the journey home. I know for a long time, at this point, I always asked, how in the world could they not have known their son wasn't with them? You see, I was thinking about this with a 21st century mind. Of course, today, if you go to any kind of celebration with your kids, when you leave, you're going to know whether they're in the car or not. In Jesus' day, families traveled in groups. You walked everywhere you went, so it was not uncommon for there to be a large group of people traveling together. It would be very easy for Mary and Joseph to think that Jesus was with someone else in the group. It wouldn't have been out of the ordinary for him not to be standing right next to them when they started off walking home. Thinking about it this way, it's not surprising to read they had traveled for a full day before they realized he was missing, and I imagine that it wasn't until they needed something from him that they started looking for him. When they didn't find him, they probably became frantic and started searching the group to see where he might be. Realizing he wasn't with their party, they returned to Jerusalem to look for him. Luke tells us after 3 days, they found him in the temple sitting among the teachers. Now, who among us wouldn't have done the same thing that Mary and Joseph did if we found out our child was missing? We would have immediately begun a frantic search looking for them. But I have to say, the last place I would look would be in a church. The Bible doesn't tell us, but I think since it took them 3 days to find him, the temple was not the first place they looked either. Mary and Joseph knew that Jesus was the Christ. They knew that he had come into the world as the salvation of the world. They should have known right away what he was doing. It should have been the first place they looked. And yet it wasn't. We do the same thing in our lives. We can go days without even thinking about Jesus and just go about our daily lives. We drive to work or school and never think about him. We watch TV, spend time with family, or go shopping without giving a thought to our Lord and Savior. We do all kinds of things, never giving a second thought to Jesus. Then when we need something or something goes wrong, who is the first person we go to? What is the first name we call on in times of trouble? We call out for God. We search frantically for him. Where is Christ? Where is he? We're like a parent looking for their lost child. We need to find Christ, and we need him now. Of course, I'm not saying there's anything wrong with calling out to him in times of trouble. In times of distress, we should absolutely look to God to see us through. But what about in our times of joy? What about the times that we get what we want? Do we see God's hand in that? Usually we don't. We think it's all because of our hard work and everything we've done. We look for Christ in the things of this world. But that is not where we're going to find him. In our sinful nature, we've become so consumed for the things of this world. We've become consumed with gaining more wealth and more possessions and more influence. We think about ourselves so much that we've pushed God out of our lives. Earthly possessions have become the priority, and God has become a distant second or even third. And that's if we think about him at all. Just last week, we celebrated Christmas, which for most people is the time they think of Christ the least. Ironic that during the time we celebrate Christ's birth, we think of him so little. But that's the time of year that it's become all about the presents and the lights and the decorations, and we don't look to Christ at all. To us, a child was born, but for many people, it's become to us a present was given. We don't look to that manger anymore. We look to ourselves. We aren't the only ones who are guilty of not looking to that manger for Christ. This week, we celebrate another group of people who came searching for Christ and went looking in the wrong place. This week is Epiphany, which is the time in which we celebrate how God revealed the gift of Christ to us. Epiphany is about God making Christ known to us. The Magi from the east came following a star to visit Christ and worship him and give him gifts. These men are Gentiles who have now come to worship the newborn King of the Jews. They had traveled hundreds of miles, and yet they did not know precisely what they would find or where they would find him. They came searching for the Christ, but weren't sure exactly where he would be. They may have thought when they arrived he would be easy to find because all the Jews would be celebrating his birth. Here are three Gentiles looking to worship the Christ. They may have expected to find him in the palace, which is why they went to Jerusalem first. That was where the temple was, and it was the center of the government. Of course you would expect to find a king there. They were looking for Christ in the wrong place. They had no way of knowing that a manger in Bethlehem, only 5 miles from Jerusalem, is where they would find him. Sadly, there are also times when we look for Christ and yet we find the wrong thing. There are so many places that we can go today that say different things about who Jesus is. People watch a show on the History Channel and all of a sudden that is what they believe is the real Jesus. It was on television, so it has to be correct, right? Or there is a movie that comes out about the life of Christ and everyone flocks to see it. Why, it must be true, because they made a movie about it, right? Or an author comes out with a new book about the life of Christ and gives you advice on ways that you should live your life. Everyone has a copy of it, and it becomes a national bestseller. It means it has to be an awesome book, right? I mean, it was on the bestseller list. The problem is, most of these shows, movies, and books have no foundation in Scripture. They are just the opinion of the person who wrote it, and it doesn't match the person of Christ we know from the Word of God. Yet we put our trust in these things as being true. That awesome show you watched last night on the History Channel was entertaining, and most of the time it's just that, entertainment. Their job is to sell advertising, and if they can't get people to watch, they can't get people to sponsor. This means they have to spice it up a little to get people's interest. The job of the movie studio is to sell tickets, so they do what they can to get people in the seats. That best-selling book by that author who purports to be an expert may not be so. He may have an agenda of his own and is trying to get you to believe what he believes. The problem is, what he believes goes against the things we know to be true in Holy Scripture. Not everything we hear, see, or read today is accurate and leading us to the one true God. In fact, in many cases, they may actually be leading us away. Where is it that we find Christ? Where do we know he will always be? Christ himself tells us right where he can be found. When Mary asks him as to why he didn't return with them, he answers, "Why were you looking for me? Did you not know that I must be in my Father's house?" Christ has a purpose and came into the world for this specific purpose. The one who knew no sin came to take on the sins of the world. Mary and Joseph spent time looking in the wrong places and didn't need to. We spend time looking in the wrong places and we don't need to. We know right where Christ can be found. He is found wherever his word is shared and his sacraments are given. To find the true Christ, we don't need to look any further than the cross in the empty tomb. We know that we find him in Holy Scripture. The Bible is the inspired, inerrant word of God. This is a book that was written by authors who were guided by the Holy Spirit and not by people who are trying to get you to believe what they believe. In this book, you won't have to look any further to find Jesus. He's right there for you. Paul tells us in his letter to the Ephesians that in him also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were sealed with the promise of the Holy Spirit. In hearing Holy Scripture read and preached here each week, you know you will find Jesus. The word of God, which has the power to forgive sins and to grant eternal life. That's where you will find Christ. This week we begin to celebrate Epiphany, which means to manifest, make known about something. It's in the Scripture that Christ is made known to us. This is where he is revealed to us. The Magi, the moment they saw him, knew that he was the Christ, and they worshipped him. They didn't have to look any further because he had been revealed to them. We know that we find our Lord and Savior here each week in the Lord's table. The true Christ is not found in that miniseries from the History Channel. He is found right here in, with, and under the bread and wine of communion. This is his body and his blood given and shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Paul also reminds us of this in his letter to the Ephesians. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses. Christ shed his blood on the cross so that the world would receive forgiveness of sins and eternal life. We find Christ when we eat his body and drink his blood here each week. This is a forgiveness that we never have to search for, but it's given to us freely. Christ is also found in the waters of holy baptism. In and through baptism, God cleanses you from all your sins and saves you from death and the devil. In your baptism, you were given an everlasting life with Christ. It's all God's doing, and nothing comes from us. It will never matter how much money we have, or how big a house we have, or any other worldly possessions. We can have all the power and influence that we want, but none of that matters. Nothing that we have done or can do matters to our salvation. Through his death on the cross, Christ did everything for you. Through his death, you have been given forgiveness for your sins. In baptism, you receive all the blessings of Christ's sacrifice. We never have to look any further than the baptismal font to see where Christ is. That's the only place that we have to look to see the forgiveness won for you. I have no idea what it would feel like to have a missing child. I've been fortunate that I've never had one of my children go missing for more than a few seconds. And when I did lose sight of them, I was able to locate them easily. I've never had to experience frantically searching for them and becoming more and more frantic the longer they were missing. I pray that this is something that no one here ever has to experience either. I do know that we will never have to search to find Christ in our lives. We know right where he is at all times. We know that he is always by our side, no matter what is happening. This is something that you are also assured of. Things will sometimes go bad in your life, but always know that Christ is right there with you, seeing you through. He will never leave. For assurance of this, you need to look no further than the words and sacraments. This is where you will always find him. In Jesus' name, amen. Now the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.